Sepsis is a serious condition that happens when the body's immune system has an extreme response to an infection, and this extreme immune response causes damage to its own tissue and organs. A study done in 2017 showed that there were 48.9 million cases worldwide and 11 million sepsis-related deaths in the same year. It's a very deadly condition and is crucial to be able to recognize it early and know what to do. Sepsis can affect anyone, but people who are older, very young, pregnant, or have other health problems are at higher risk. In this video, we're going to answer the questions, what is sepsis? And we're going to do that by going through the definition, then go through the pathophysiology for sepsis, basically what happens within the body. Then we're going to talk a little bit about the causes. After that, we will briefly go through what the symptoms of sepsis are using a mnemonic. Then we're going to go through the recent clinical criteria to be able to recognize this disease early. And lastly, we will briefly talk about the measures and treatment for this condition using an example. So let's start with the definition. Sepsis is the body's extreme response to an infection. What does that mean? It means that sepsis starts with an infection that you already have that triggers a chain reaction throughout the body. In 2017, the largest contributors to sepsis cases and sepsis-related mortality across all ages were diarrheal diseases and lower respiratory infections. But infections in the urinary system and skin may also cause sepsis. Look here, a simple scheme to show how this condition develops would look like this, or in other words, the pathophysiology. Sepsis starts off with an infection. Let's say there's an infection in the lungs, a pneumonia. Let's take a detailed look at the lungs of this affected person. We'll be able to see the blood vessels, interstitium, and cell. Let's add the bacteria, any type of common bacterial infections, whether that may be gram-positive or gram-negative. Let's say that the infection is in the space between the cells and the blood vessels now. What happens is that cells in your innate immune system, like this macrophage, is going to engulf some of these bacteria and release inflammatory mediators. There are many things that happen simultaneously, but the overall effect is that any damaged epithelium or activated immune cells will release these inflammatory mediators, like the prostaglandins, leukotrienes, interleukin-1, interleukin-6, TNF-α, and so on. These inflammatory mediators are crucial to the development of a septic condition. Look here, with all of these inflammatory mediators, we are going to attract a lot of other white blood cells, like you see here how this neutrophil is making its way into the area. These mediators will also cause the blood vessel to dilate, vasodilation, to increase the blood supply to this inflamed area, and an increase in permeability, meaning that water will leak into the interstitial space. Usually, this is good, but the problem now is that what if this reaction happens in an extreme level? What if there's a dysregulated cytokine release and these inflammatory mediators keep getting released? How does the body respond if the effect of those mediators starts getting severe? All of those inflammatory mediators are now in your bloodstream, keep getting released by active cells as part of the response of the infection. What happens now is that you're going to start having fever. These interleukins will make their way to the temperature center in the hypothalamus and trigger a fever, along with release of acute phase proteins like CRP and all of those things. Another thing that will happen is that you see all of that fluid leaking out of the capillaries. What happens when this inflammation isn't regulated anymore if this happens so extremely that you start losing fluid within the actual blood vessels? You start getting a decreased blood volume, and as a reaction to that, you get a decreased blood pressure. And if that's not bad enough, if you decrease the systolic blood pressure, as well as damaging the endothelium, inflammatory mediators can affect the cardiac return, meaning less blood enters the heart, which again decreases the cardiac output, or the amount of blood going out from the heart to the body. So the body doesn't get their normal supply of oxygen and blood anymore. Along with all of this, you will also get damaged tissue. Now, if we get fluid within the interstitium, you'll get local edema, which decreases the oxygen supply to our cells. And as you know, tissue hypoxia leads to an anaerobic metabolic response, which can increase the lactate. Lactate is acidic. And if you decrease the cardiac output, this might happen systemically within the whole body. As all of this is happening, endothelial cells might lose their anticoagulant function after a pro-inflammatory stimulation and promote coagulation by decreasing the expression of thrombomodulin and heparin sulfate on the cell surface, as well as increasing the expression of tissue factor. All of this may activate the coagulation cascade and cause a sepsis-induced coagulopathy, meaning you have a higher chances of getting blood clot. Alright, so there's a whole lot of things that happens. This is just an overview to show you that a dysregulated immune response has a systemic severe reaction. So what actually causes sepsis? In most cases, a bacterial infection is the source, with agents like Staphylococcus aureus, Pseudomonas, and E. coli accounting to the majority of cases. But it can be other infections as well, like viruses, fungi, and parasitic infections. The novel coronavirus caused a lot of sepsis cases as well. Would be interesting to see some statistics on that. The most common site of primary infections are lower respiratory tract infections like pneumonia, as well as abdominal infections and from the genitourinary tract. But it can be from any source. In elderly, infections in the urinary tract is very common. Sepsis comes from the word septicemia, meaning blood poisoning. But the blood doesn't necessarily have to be contaminated to cause sepsis. It can be, the blood may be infected as well, but not necessarily. And it's actually also common in some cases to not find any sources of infections at all. Now, how do you actually recognize the symptoms of a septic patient? Let's go through the clinical features. The symptoms vary a lot, but a good mnemonic to remember is Taim, just like my name. T stands for temperature. It can be high due to fever or low since the patient has low blood pressure and also decreased cardiac output. The circulation will be compromised and as a result, the blood can get centralized and the patient may get very cold. So either high temperature or low. I stands for infection. Signs and symptoms can vary a lot depending on both the causative agent and the location of the infection. So a lower respiratory tract infection gives symptoms like cough and dyspnea. In the GI tract, like diarrhea, vomit, abdominal pain, and so on. If you get a severe reaction and you decrease the blood supply to the brain, the patient might have an altered mental status. So it's quite common to find a septic patient that is confused, sleepy, and sometimes they may be difficult to rouse, difficult to wake up, basically. E stands for extremely ill. The patient might have a severe pain. They may have a discomfort no matter the position they're lying in, and they may have shortness of breath. Those are the main symptoms related to sepsis. Now, sepsis is a clinical diagnosis and is crucial to recognize the possibility of sepsis early, preferably within seconds to minutes. And this is done primarily through some screening tools. So recent guidelines, at least from 2021 till the date of making this video, suggest that first, there has to be a presence of infection. That's number one. You see a patient, you suspect an infection. That's number one. Together with the infection, there are two screening tools that is used nowadays to be able to identify patients at high risk for sepsis. It's a QSOFA and use. The QSOFA score ranges from 0 to 3, with 1 point each for systolic hypotension of 100 or under, tachypnea of 22 breaths or higher per minute, or altered mental status. A QSOFA score of 2 or above has a predictive value for sepsis. The other screening tool is a National Early Warning Score, or NEWS. NEWS is a scoring system derived from the 6 physiological parameters, including respiratory rate, oxygen saturation, systolic blood pressure, heart rate, altered mental status, and the temperature. And here, a score of 5 or above can be used to predict the chances of sepsis. So, the way this goes is that there has to be a presence of an infection, plus QSOFA score of 2 or above, or NEWS score 5 or above. There are other scoring systems as well, like the SIRS criteria, but recently there has been a shift of usage from SIRS to QSOFA and NEWS. Now you found out the possibility of sepsis. What do you do first? So first, we need to secure blood cultures prior to the antibiotic administration, because we need to localize the infection, as well as find out the causative agent for later targeted therapy. Then we need to measure lactate. As we said earlier, if you have a tissue hypoxia, that may lead to anaerobic metabolism, which might increase the lactate. There are many factors that influence the lactate level here. Anaerobic metabolism is just one cause, but it can also be causes like a decreased hepatic clearance, increased beta adrenergic stimulation, and so on. Lactate is a very important prognostic tool to see the severity of sepsis. And we have to measure the urine output. So why do we need to check the urine output? You check the urine output as a way to check for organ dysfunction. If you have an organ dysfunction, the kidneys won't be able to filter the blood optimally, and you will have a decrease to non-urine production. So you want to maintain a urine production higher than 0.5 milliliters per kilogram per hour. This is also a way to check the severity of sepsis. Then we have to give IV fluids. This is a crucial part because remember, our main problem right now is that we have a decreased blood pressure and decreased blood volume. We also need to try to keep an oxygen saturation of above 94%, primarily for people with healthy lungs from before. If they have any respiratory illnesses from before, you would want this number to be lower to not get CO2 retention. Then we need to treat the cause of sepsis. So we give empiric antibiotics first, then a targeted therapy later when the causative agent is known. So these are the general measures. Now let's put this to practice. Imagine you're working late at the hospital and you get called to go check on a patient that is admitted for an infection. They've gotten worse, they have a systolic blood pressure of 88, they breathe fast, and they have an altered mental status. So you already know within seconds that this patient has an infection and have a QSOFA score of 2 or above, or a new score of 5 or above. So the sepsis diagnosis is established within seconds. What do you do now? You're standing next to the patient. We start fluid resuscitation. So we start with IV crystalloid solution, give a bolus of 500 milliliters, and we continue to give fluids up until 30 milliliters per kilogram given within the first hour, with continuous monitoring of blood pressure. We have to secure 2 IV lines just in case, and we need to consider a urine catheter. I say consider because not all patients need it. Some patients can still give an estimate of urine output. And again, this is to check the severity of organ dysfunction. Then after that, we need to measure. Do the patient have a persistent hypotension or not? If the patient has a persistent hypotension without hypovolemia, then that is enough to think that this is a septic shock. So we have to start some type of pressors to increase the blood pressure again, using drugs like noradrenaline. If the patient now has a higher blood pressure after giving fluid, we continue to give fluid, while now we also need to start giving antibiotics. And for that, you need to check the guidelines because there are different antibiotics you give based on the location of the infection and also the endemic region, country the patient's located in. And so the antibiotics has to be started within the first hour. Then after that, we need to set a treatment goal. Usually, we want the patient to be stable within the first 6 hours. So we want to keep a mean arterial pressure of above 65. We want to keep a urine output of higher than 0.5 milliliters per kilogram per hour, and we need to strive for an oxygen saturation within an acceptable value, that is 94% for people with healthy lungs, and a little bit lower for people with known respiratory diseases like COPD.